Okay, moving on to neoplasms. So neoplasms can be benign or malignant. The most important thing to know is that majority of neoplasms in salivary glands will occur in the parotid gland, and majority will be benign. So if you have a look up here, you can see that the sublingual gland is most commonly associated with a malignant neoplasm. So just think about it, high risk zone, we've talked about it with everything, ulcers and white patches and everything. So again, if you find like a salivary neoplasm right down at the floor of the mouth, sublingual gland, then you're thinking, okay, very high chance of it being malignant. Then you have the minor salivary glands, and then submandibular, and then the least malignancy risk is the parotid. So again, most of the tumors happen in the parotid, and most of them will be benign. And of the benign ones, the most common one is the pleomorphic adenoma. So pleomorphic adenoma, again, you want to just, all benign tumors will present in this way. So it will be slow growing over several years, be soft, rubbery, it'll be mobile, and it won't be associated with any like nerve problems or pain or anything like that. Now, in terms of this, like the actual tissue component, so you find, you see a swelling up here, so either like the superior lobe, lower pole, we call it. Take a fine needle aspiration of it, and you find very mixed tissue. So pleomorphic, meaning that there's just so many different morphs, different shapes, different things in there. And you'll find like cartilage, bone, connective tissue, stroma, just everything. And it's very disorganized, mixed tissue. So that's the distinguishing factor. We've talked about how it presents, and treatment-wise, very important. It's like a mucoseal, so you want to excise it with a clear margin. Make sure you take all of it out without spilling. So if you cause spilling, you'll cause like a wide seed spread. So again, all this tissue, connective tissue, bone, cartilage, whatnot, all of it will just be in areas where they don't belong, and then they will seed together and they will cause little tumors by themselves. And then what you'll end up doing is like, okay, I can't go in and excise all of those. Probably gonna have to go for radiotherapy, because this tumor, if long-standing, has a risk to become malignant. So this one's the carcinoma ex pleomorphic adenoma. We'll get to that later. So that's why recurrence is very, very likely if you don't excise it with clear margins, and you might have to then go in with radiotherapy. Another thing about excising pleomorphic adenomas is this risk of nerve damage. So if I were to get a question on pleomorphic adenomas, I would 100% mention like risk and benefits of this clear excision. So it's either clearly excising but risking potential damage to nearby structures. So like the facial nerve passes through the parotid, you don't want to damage that. There's also like a lymph node and whatnot, other structures near the parotid gland, you don't want to damage them. But then if I don't give a clear margin, then I'm risking that spillage. So it's a balance. Right, pleomorphic adenomas can present in the submandibular, can also present in the minor salivary gland. So if you found a big lump of myxoid tissue in the palate, then it's probably a pleomorphic adenoma of the minor salivary gland. And I think the most typical presentation of those ones are a junction of the hard and soft palate. Okay? Now, three more benign tumors of the parotid. So you have one is a Worthen's tumor. I'm not going to go into detail because I think these are all differential diagnoses. Like, oh yeah, it could be this and it could be that. And you just know like one or two points about it. So Worthen's tumor, again, parotid benign tumor. And it presents typically in elderly men who smoke, and if you did a fine needle aspiration, you will find lots of lymph tissue surrounded by I think they're oncocytes, yeah, they'd be surrounded by cells that have large mitochondria. Okay, these are called oncocytes, so they're huge cells, really compact nucleus, and a really large mitochondria surrounding lymph tissue will be a Worthen's tumor. But if you found a tumor with just lots of oncocytes, then it's an oncocytoma. Okay, so again, just tiny little details about each one, and I think it'll be fine. So, and then you have the basal cell adenoma, very similar to pleomorphic, but you can excise it very readily. Excise it. All of these, yeah, you can fine needle aspirate to get a confirmed diagnosis. And then the last benign tumor that we'll talk about is the canalicular adenoma. So this is the question that says, you have a mucosal or a mucosal looking thing, a lump in the upper lip. What is it? Very rare that you'll get a mucosal unless you're biting your upper lip, but it's not typical. So you would want to put in your differential a canalicular adenoma, because it's a benign tumor of the minor salivary glands, so present in the lips, that typically presents in the upper lip. Okay, so it's very important because it fits the look, it fits the structure, it fits the site. So to put canalicular adenoma, typically presents upper lip, buccal mucosa, so minor salivary gland sites, and again, readily excisable. Okay, moving on to...
So malignant neoplasms, these ones, if you compare to the benign ones, they'll present differently. So they'll be hard, they'll be immobile, they'll probably be associated with nerve damage or weakness or altered sensation and pain. And then also you might find that the speed of growth. So we always know that malignancy is just rapid destruction, whereas with salivary glands, the problem is that initially it can actually be slow growing. Lots of these are slow growing. There's only two or three that are fast. And that's I think that's the problem when it comes to determining malignant benign. So biopsy if it's weird presentation. Anyway, most common malignant carcinoma is the mucoepidermoid carcinoma. Okay, so these ones will be, I think the most common site is actually the submandibular gland, even though remember sublingual has the highest risk of being malignant, but the mucoepidermoid carcinoma is usually associated with the submandibular and is the most common malignant carcinoma. Now, so what is it? It's a mucus-filled cyst that's lined with epithelium, as the name suggests, and you wanna excise widely, and has really slow growth. Okay, so there's not much information in that one, but it can present in all of them. So parotid, submandibular, sublingual, and minor salivary gland. And if it's associated, let's say, in the lip or something, it can be mistaken for mucosal. So if you put mucosal anywhere, you wanna put mucoepidermoid carcinoma just in case, okay? Okay, next one, adenoid cystic carcinoma. Okay, cystic, just remember that you're having fluid, it's more fluid, so you can fine needle aspirate this one. When they talk about investigations, benign ones, you're gonna fine needle aspirate. Malignant ones, typically biopsy it. I think one of them you don't, but anyway, the only one that you will fine needle aspirate is this adenoid cystic carcinoma, and you can do that because it's cystic, it's a lot softer. Also, adenoid, this one's associated with nerve spread, so just think about it, adenoid, adenerve, so just use that N in the middle to remember that this is the one that travels along the nerve. So this one is a slow-growing one, but it travels down the nerve. If it's in the parotid, it will travel down the facial nerve, and it can cause pain, it can cause facial weakness. And on an MRI, if you did an MRI scan, you can find thickening of the nerve. And once this one's a really high-grade carcinoma, so once you diagnose this, it's a very poor outcome. And on biopsy, you will find, or fine needle aspiration, you would find the Swiss cheese appearance. And there's lots of empty cells, but if you just talk about the Swiss cheese appearance on histology, then that is the adenoid cystic carcinoma. Okay? The third one that I mentioned that you might want to talk about is
the polymorphous adenocarcinoma. So they all sound the same. But this one's associated with minor salivary glands.
Okay. So, recap. Mucoepidermoid carcinoma, most common malignant carcinoma, and can happen in all of the salivary glands, but typically submandibular. Then there's the adenoid cystic carcinoma, also can happen anywhere, but I think is also commonly associated with the parotid. Now, a version of the adenoid cystic carcinoma is found only in minor salivary gland cells. So this is the polymorphous adenocarcinoma. It's a low-grade cancerous tumor. Now, this one you'll remember that it's also associated with nerves because it has that adeno, the N. So adenoid cystic carcinoma is adenerve, travels along the nerve, and then there is polymorphous, so a variant, so polymorph, like a different shape of the adenerve carcinoma, adenocarcinoma. So it also travels along the nerve, but it's just a slightly different look. Because it's minor salivary gland, it will present on the palate and is histologically misdiagnosed as the adenoid cystic carcinoma. Find Swiss cheese, and you would also find perineural spread, and I'm sure there are other ways to distinguish between the two, but I think if you're going to compare, those are the things you can say. Okay, and then the last malignant one that I'll talk about is the carcinoma ex pleomorphic adenoma, another very high grade cancerous one. This is patient has a history of a pleomorphic adenoma, and it's very slow at first, but then at one point, boom, it will hit rapid and it will just invade. So that's why it's very important when you have a pleomorphic adenoma that you tell the patient that, hello, it can become cancerous. I know you want to leave it there because you don't want to risk facial weakness, but there is a risk that it can become cancerous. So that's why it's risky for the patient, okay? So it'll be slow growing, they're thinking nothing's happening, and then suddenly rapid invasion, you get facial nerve weakness, lymphadenopathy, and this carcinoma can be of different types, okay? So pleomorphic adenoma has different cells in it, so the carcinoma can be associated with different types of tissue. Okay, the other ones are just here written on the side. So acinic cell carcinoma looks benign on histology, no idea how you're going to differentiate it. Secretory cell is similar to breast cell, like breast carcinoma. Salivary duct cell, rapid growth, you'll find Roman bridges. Again, very fast nerve spread and lymphadenopathy, that's a high grade one. And then epithelial, myoepithelial carcinoma. I'm just reading it out because it's like they're shortened. Just make sure that you have the full words. And this one is ducts and islands of epithelium with clear myoepithelial cells. I wouldn't worry too much about them. I would just write them down, names, one-liners, because there's nothing in the book. So they can't expect us to know much about it. One important thing, though, about these carcinomas and these tumors and swellings, you want to rule out a lymphoma or a lymphangioma or hemangioma. I don't even think lymphangioma is a thing. Sorry, so lymphomas and hemangiomas. Sjogren's is very associated to a multiform of lymphoma. They have increased risk of that. So if you have a salivary gland disease and a swelling, if they have history of Sjogren's and I think could be unilateral, could be bilateral, not too sure, but you can develop lymphomas. Children from young age could have small benign tumors of the blood vessels called hemangiomas. Like, you can present here-ish region. You can also get lymphomas in this region because there are parotid lymph nodes. So you want to rule out that it's not that. So again, you get swelling, differential diagnosis is lymphoma and hemangioma, you do include it, but you say you rule it out. Okay? I didn't talk about Sjogren's and dry mouth and like other salivary gland disease, like excessive saliva, but I can talk a tiny little bit about it. Excessive saliva is very easy, so tylism. If they ask you about salivary gland problems, you can talk about, oh, excessive saliva, and you talk about, it could be just a normal reaction, so anxiety in the dental chair can actually cause, like, I don't know if you've ever seen a submandibular gland, it's just, like, excessively excrete saliva. But then you can also have, I think typically the most common cause is false tylism, so false excessive saliva, and it's actually because you get pooling of saliva because you're not swallowing it, so it's usually motor diseases, so like motor nerve diseases like Parkinson's or cerebral palsy. They don't swallow, they end up with too much saliva. You can give them drugs that cause xerostomia, or like certain drugs, obviously, not just random ones, that will decrease the amount of saliva they produce so that you can balance it with the lack of swallowing. Okay, xerostomia, I'm not going to talk too much about it. Talk a lot. Xerostomia can be caused by several things. So, of course, we know primary and secondary Sjogren's. I have a gut feeling this is coming up in the exam, just saying. Primary and secondary Sjogren's. So, primary will be dry mouth, so an autoimmune dry mouth that's not associated with a connective tissue disease, whereas secondary will be like rheumatoid plus and causing Sjogren's as well. All of them, tests wise, you want to do like autoantibody tests for SSA and SSB, which is also Rho and La, same thing. And you're going to also test for like rheumatoid factor just to rule out any connective tissue diseases. Okay, this is, I'm talking about, you have xerostomia, what tests are you doing? You're also doing whole salivary flow, because that will also help diagnose the Sjogren's. So that's the 10 minutes spitting into a bottle, and then you want to make sure, I think 0.2 ml per minute, less than that is dry mouth, like real dry mouth. And then also you can do like a biopsy of the minor salivary glands, and there are a few others. Next, if you've ruled out primary Sjogren's, you've ruled out secondary Sjogren's, then you have like your radiation. So history of radiation can cause dry mouth because you've just like radiated the, you've fried the salivary glands. They don't produce saliva. And there are also certain drugs. So how I remember this, think about it. So you produce saliva when you're like in the resting and digesting stage, so when your parasympathetic nervous system is activated. So any drug that counters parasympathetic nervous system will cause dry mouth. Okay, so anticholinergics. And then also, again, if you think about it, when you're nervous and your sympathetic system is working, you get a dry mouth. So any drug that would mimic the sympathetic nervous system, so sympathomimetic drugs, will cause dry mouth. Okay? Diseases wise, dry mouth is caused by dehydration. So any disease that causes dehydration or excessive loss of water, whether it be because you're urinating it out, because you're sweating it out, these diseases will like predispose you to dry mouth. So could be what? It could be hyperhidrosis, so that excessive sweating disease. Could be hyperthyroidism, so you have that really like thin, aggressive, like agitated, very sweaty female, right? That's how I've always pictured hyperthyroidism. And diabetes. Okay? I think those are just like quick things to remember, help you remember, because there's so much on like dry mouth and Sjogren's. Treating wise, obviously, we know like the sprays and the gels that cause sugar-free chewing gums, anything to instigate salivary flow. But yeah, that was a very long one. If you lived through it, congratulations. I'm not too confident on this one myself, so that's why with the cutting, but I wouldn't worry too much as long as you know like the important ones and just like key points. I think you'll pass, and good luck. I hope we all do well, and I shall see you later. Goodbye. Thank you for watching.